Hello. Good evening. Can you hear me? Good. Welcome. Thank you for coming out on this autumn night to hear our next installment of the Adams Sweeting Lecture Series. My name is Bob Nicol. I'm the Pro Vice Chancellor Executive Dean for the Faculty of Engineering and Physical Sciences, and I'm going to be your MC tonight. So you'll see me a bit later when we will do the Q&A with Sheila. Before I invite our Vice Chancellor to come up and give the opening remarks and introduce Sheila to you, I'm going to do a bit of housekeeping just to let you know this shouldn't be a fire alarm. If there is, please leave carefully but swiftly through the exits. So we're not expecting any excitement tonight of that kind. And also, if you could, if you don't mind, just turn your phones to silent, that would be much appreciated. So it now gives me great pleasure to invite Professor Max Liu, the Vice Chancellor of Surrey, to come and introduce Sheila to us.
Thank you, Bob, and ladies and gentlemen, it's a great pleasure to be here to welcome you all on campus. So Bob is very modest. He didn't say he's one of the leading astronomers, astrophysicists in the world, one of the highly cited physicists as well. So he certainly knows the subject. So on behalf of the university, I'd like to welcome everyone, and particularly our very honored speaker, Professor Sheila Rowan, and all other distinguished guests to this Adams Sweeting Lecture. I think it was Albert Einstein who said, "The soul given to each of us is moved by the same living spirit that moves the universe." Well, in the case of tonight's guest speaker, I think it's fair to say that Sheila's soul is deeply attuned to the very rhythms of the universe itself. Like many successful scientists, Sheila's journey in science was ignited by a bold ambition, one that wasn't without risks. So Einstein had long predicted the existence of gravitational waves, but their detection had eluded scientists for decades. So there's no surprise, perhaps, when you are searching for a movement that is smaller than the nucleus of the atom. But ever since her days as undergraduate in Glasgow, the idea of developing a whole new way of listening to what the universe tells us had inspired Sheila in the lab. That earlier work on making detectors evolved into a collaboration with the famous laser interferometer gravitational wave observatory, in acronym LIGO, in 2015. LIGO detected the first gravitational wave just 3 weeks after her cutting-edge, very specialized mirror was installed in LIGO's facility. And talking about making an impact. So it was a surprise to get the results so soon, right, Sheila? You're nodding. But what a result that was. Those detectors were so sensitive to capture waves produced 1.3 billion years ago when a new black hole was born, and following a collision of two black holes. So remarkably, the detection occurred on the 100-year anniversary of Einstein's prediction of the general relativity, while the announcement of the news took place on the 100-year anniversary of the prediction of the existence of gravitational waves. You could say it was a universe way of saying, well done. That, as they say, was just the start. Sheila went on to become a leading scientist and become the chief scientific advisor to the Scottish government, the president of the Institute of Physics, In 2021, New Year's honors, and she was promoted to the Commander of Order of the British Empire for her services to science. It was only natural that Sheila should go on to research gravitational waves in space with ongoing interest in the studies of ultra-sensitive mechanic systems and investigations into how to make optical systems for interferometry applications are mechanically stable. And this will have implications in many other scientific endeavors. This puts Sheila at the forefront of her field and more than a fitting speaker for tonight's lecture, which has a proud tradition of hearing from eminent scientists at the frontiers of science and technology. Of course, many of you know you've been here before. This lecture bears the name of two Surrey pioneers, Professor of Adams and Professor Sir Martin Sweeting, both of whom are here, whose achievements in science technology have been extraordinary, that have inspired the whole community of scientists and engineers to really advance the frontiers of science and technology for the benefit of everyone in society. I'm delighted to have an eminent scientist, astrophysicist in today's lecture, Sheila, who have been pushing the boundaries of knowledge, as we heard, and through inquiries and innovation and translating her ideas into something very impactful in scientific discovery. So similarly, I think Professor Alf Adams, as you know, who pioneered the first generation of laser by inventing the strained layer quantum well laser, and Professor Sir Martin Sweeting for pioneering small satellite systems. The impact of their world-changing discoveries and inventions is simply huge. Besides the inventions of the solid-state laser and small satellite here at Surrey, we also take a great pride in our record of many undertakings, world-leading researchers in AI and sustainability and many other areas, health, medical sciences, and humanities, social sciences. So, ladies and gentlemen, Sheila is a very fitting speaker, and I think, Sheila, also you are in very good company. I would like to salute you for your dedication and persistence you have shown in the pursuit of your pioneering research. Now, it gives me great pleasure to invite our guest speaker tonight, Professor Sheila Rowan, please.
Thank you very much, that's great, thank you. Well, thank you very much for that introduction and for the invitation to come and speak to you this evening. It is an absolute pleasure to be here. You'll see the title, A Perspective on Discovery, Gravitational Waves, and I am this evening going to give you a personal perspective. There are many people who've been involved in the work that I'm going to talk about, and each and every one of them would have their own perspective, I think, on things. So you're going to get mine tonight. And I'm going to try and give you a flavour of a whole variety of things, definitely the science. I'm also going to talk a lot about the history of the field, about what it was like to be in the field through the fantastic discovery of gravitational waves that Professor Lee talked about, and a little bit about the future, what's coming next and where are we going. So, first of all though, if I'm going to talk about gravitational waves, I think I need to do a little bit of explanation as to what gravitational waves are. So I think you'll recognize there Einstein, he's on the cover of Science magazine in 2015, and as you heard, that was the 100th anniversary of his general theory of relativity. And that theory describes gravity in many ways. And in a very particular way, it talks about gravity, the gravity that we think of as a force between objects holding us here on the surface of the Earth. It talks about gravity in terms of geometry, in terms of, if you look at the graphic on the right-hand side there, you see that grid. And if you imagine That grid is marking out distances in the universe. And where there's no object there, you can see those lines are nice and straight. But then when we place an object in our universe, the lines start to curve. The mass of the object has curved space-time around it, and distances start to change. You can imagine then, if we added a second object to our universe, it would feel that curve in space. Its motion would change. And so there's a sort of well-known expression that says space-time, the space tells matter, objects, how to move, and objects tell the space around them, the space-time around them, how to curve. And so in this picture, gravity is that curvature that objects experience as they try and move in space-time. So if you've got a second object, you can imagine if we plonked it on a sheet, it would also try and stretch space around it, but it would roll down that curve. The objects would appear to move together. And that is what we experience as gravity. It's that curvature in space-time. So if then we have two objects, you can see here our two stars, say, out somewhere in the universe, and they're caught in one another's gravity. They're spiraling around together, each one of them distorting distances around it. The two of them spiraling in together, and those distortions, that curvature, ripples out across space-time. It ripples out across the universe. And in fact, Einstein's special theory of relativity says something that I think people are perhaps familiar with hearing, that no information can be transferred faster than the speed of light. That includes gravitational information, so actually there must be traveling gravitational signals. There must be gravitational radiation. So what we call gravitational waves are those ripples in space-time traveling across the universe caused by things like dense stars moving and distorting space-time around them. And they have a physical effect. That physical effect is to stretch and squash distances. That's how we perceive the effects of gravitational waves. Two objects, their distances are stretched and squashed. Their separation between them is stretched and squashed. That's the effect of gravitational waves. However, there is a but. To measure that effect, you need to be able to measure changes in distances that are smaller than 100 million times, there are 100 million times smaller than the size of an atom. So you've got two objects, their separation's being changed, but it's really not being changed very much, and that's an exceedingly challenging measurement to make. And for many years, again, people thought not possible to make. People were very skeptical that it could be done. But there's a prize for being able to do it, and that prize is being able to study our universe in a way that's not possible by any other means. So in this animation here, you'll see two black circles on the screen there in this animation. Those are what we call black holes. So each one of those represents a star, a bit bigger than our own sun, that's come to the end of its life. It's run out of the fuel that has been holding it up. It's burned through its fuel. Gravity's relentless, so the star collapses down. It collapses down under its own gravity, and it collapses down into a region of space where gravity is so strong that nothing can escape its pull, not even light. And that's, again, why we call these black holes. Here we had two black holes that had been spiraling around one another, losing energy as they did so until eventually they collided and a new black hole was born. So I'll run this animation for you again. We have these two black holes, two dead stars, the endpoints of stars collapsing, caught in one another's gravity, and each one of those is stretching the space around it. It's producing gravitational waves, those ripples in space-time as the stars orbit round one another. They're spreading out. And if we here on Earth had two objects, we monitored the separation of those objects as the ripples passed through them on Earth, we would discover that their separation was changing. They were being stretched back and forward. as the gravitational waves produced by this event passed through them. As the black holes get closer and closer together, the wobbles get larger, the objects are being stretched and squashed faster and faster. When the black holes merge, that effect is most. Then as the new black hole's born, it sort of wobbles a little bit as it settles down. And if you're watching the timer up there, and this all happened, those last cycles here, in a fraction of a second. That signal, as it's transmitted out across the universe, and the exact shape of the signal, carries with it information about what produced it. So the prize for making these measurements is being able to study objects out there in the cosmos that don't, we think, emit any light. And we wouldn't be able to detect them any other way. So it's a different way, completely different way to study our universe. And indeed, you'll see that very characteristic shape appearing in the middle plot here. And what you see here is a plot from the publication that came out in 2016. As you've heard, that was the 100th anniversary of Einstein predicting the existence of gravitational waves. And you can see two plots on the left. This is information that's come from an observatory, the LIGO Hanford Observatory in Washington State. And on the right, the signal detected in the Livingston Observatory in Louisiana. And you can see the shape of those as the signal passed through one instrument, passed through one observatory, and then the other. And encoded in that shape, in the way that these observatories have picked up the signal, the frequency of those wobbles, those oscillations, the size of them, encoded in that is information about what produced them. And in fact, we can tell from the signal that these were black holes. When they collided, they produced a new black hole that was in size, it was about 366 kilometers. What does that mean? Well, that's about the size of Iceland. That's the size of the black hole. But it had a mass of 62 times the mass of our own sun, squashed into that size. We can tell it was spinning. It was spinning about 100 times a second. We can tell a point on its edge, its horizon, was spinning about 100 times a second at nearly half the speed of light. And all of that information is encoded in the shape of the signal that we pick up. So it's quite an extraordinary thing to be able to do. And indeed, the Nobel Prize in Physics in 2017 was awarded to my three colleagues on the screen there, Ray Weiss, Barry Barish, and Kip Thorne. For many reasons, this was a remarkable achievement, and they have led, again, the collaboration through this. But again, the Nobel Committee, you can see the citation underneath there, points out this is a collaborative project with over 1,000 researchers from more than 20 countries, and that it took decades of persistence and perseverance, and I'll talk a little bit about that, to get to that point. So it's very important to say that all the work I'm going to talk about today involved many people. Again, lots of people. These are the logos. You can hunt and pick your favorite institution in there. Mine's in there somewhere. There's plenty of other UK institutions in there. But they're from all around the globe working together to achieve this. And that's a very different way to do science, I think, than sometimes people are used to. But this was such a large challenge. It required that, again, it required the ingenuity of all those folks to make it happen. Now, one of the reasons I think the Nobel Prize was deserved, I think, is encapsulated on the slide here. So in case you can't read it, the first panel says, here's what a binary black hole coalescence looks like. Oh, there it goes. Oh, no, that's over, you missed it. Because that's what you would see, that's what people did see if they took their telescopes and pointed them at the portion of the sky where two black holes are colliding. You don't see anything. And yet, you'll have seen on the previous slide, we're able to actually study the objects that are out there, find out their properties, and as we'll see, learn more about how they've been behaving, how they've been forming across the universe. So how do we make these detections when the effect that they cause on objects is so tiny? Well, the effect is quite a characteristic one. If you imagine somewhere far out the back of the electrothetan in the universe, two objects have been spiraling round, sending out gravitational waves. They've come across the universe, they've come in through the electrothetan, they're going into the board, passing through. And what we're seeing is the effect that they would have on a ring of dots. If we drew a ring of dots in a circle, it's a very characteristic distortion. The effect of the gravitational wave going into the board would cause those dots to separate in one direction at the same time as dots at right angles to them were squashed in, and they oscillate back and forth. It's a very characteristic effect. However, again, to put that into perspective, the width of one of your hairs, if you hold that in your mind, it's about 50 microns. The size of a typical atom is about 100,000 times smaller than the width of your hair. And the changes in those positions of those dots that we're searching for is 100 million times smaller than the size of the atom. So this is hugely exaggerated for effect, because otherwise you would see nothing. So how did people start to do this? Well, that prediction happened back in 1916, and actually for decades nothing happened, because actually even Einstein himself wasn't convinced that these things had physical meaning, that they could be detected. And the challenge was so hard that actually nothing happened for many years, until there was a meeting, I think, in 1957, when in the US, a famous meeting, the Chapel Hill meeting, where Felix Pirani came along and suggested actually that there could be a physical effect. That ring of particles was something that could be studied. At that meeting was a guy called Joe Weber. It's a picture of Joe Weber on the screen there, and he was inspired by thinking about this to try and build a detector. And what he did, you'll see a big bar of metal there, was build a bar detector, in fact two, that were separated, one at Argonne Lab and one at the University of Maryland, separated in those two labs, and then he instrumented them to look for changes in their shape effectively. You can imagine a gravitational wave passing through that bar, causing it to sort of ring. And he was instrumenting it, you can see there, with detectors that changed that physical vibration into an electrical signal. And he believed that he had detected gravitational waves, that he got coincident events, and you'll see from the start, there were two instruments, so that if you see something in one, you make sure you've seen it in the other, to be confident that there's something there. And he published that, 1969, Evidence for the Discovery of Gravitational Radiation. Other groups around the world thought this was incredibly exciting, and they all set up their own detectors, because science works by replication of phenomena. Once is not enough. So there were groups in Germany and Russia, in the US, in Italy, in France, and indeed the UK, who all set up their own detectors. This is a picture of the bar detector in Glasgow that was set up at that time. I think just by the photograph, I'll let you guess what the era was. The chap in the right-hand side in the corduroy jacket was actually my PhD supervisor. That's Jim Huff. Looking very dapper there. Those were the days where you wore your corduroy jacket to the laboratory when you did your physics experiments. So that's the Glasgow bar detector. But in fact, neither it nor any of the other experiments that were set up could replicate the finding, could detect anything that looked like gravitational waves. And eventually the field came to the conclusion that Joe had not made a detection, although I think to the end of his life he never accepted that. He always believed that he had seen something. They really weren't sensitive enough when you look at the numbers. It really needed a more sensitive technique. And actually, you can see even before the bar detector work there, in Russia, shortly after the invention of the laser, two Russian scientists again outlined the idea for using laser light to monitor the motion of hanging mirrors and how those mirrors would respond to a gravitational wave. And there were, in quick succession, various people took that forward, again almost in parallel. Bob Forward in the US, Rhee Weiss at MIT, again one of the Nobel Prize winners you saw there. going on with Ray to found the LIGO project, the LIGO observatories, along with Kip Thorne and actually Ron Drever, who came from the Glasgow group, who founded the Gravitational Waves group in Glasgow and then moved to Caltech, and the three of them really set up LIGO. So how does laser interferometry help us? So there's a ring of particles again. Imagine at the top, one of those red dots is a mirror, and at right angles, there's another mirror. We take light from a laser. You can think of light as a wave. We split that in two at a beam splitter. So half the light goes one way, half goes the other way. Those waves go out, bounce off the mirrors, and come back again to the beam splitter, where they can, depending on how far they've traveled, if you have two peaks in the wave come back at the same time, they'll add up and you'll get a bright spot. If, on the other hand, a gravitational wave has passed by, stretched one arm of this, squashed the other, the two light waves no longer necessarily come back as peaks. You could have a peak and a trough which cancel out and you get a dark spot. So by monitoring the brightness of the light at the output of our device, we are sensitive to the motion of the mirrors, and we look for motions caused by passing gravitational waves. And that can be very sensitive, because you're easily sensitive to motions that are less than the wavelength of light. So it can be a very sensitive device. Still, though, it's challenging. Gravitational waves, and I won't go into detail, but I'm happy to talk about it later, are what are called tidal effects. And what that means is the further apart we put our objects, the bigger the effect is. So we want to make these instruments large. To develop this technique, indeed, people started with laboratory prototypes and then worked out how to scale the technology up. So although we spend a lot of time drawing stick diagrams, reality really goes in this direction. And the technology involved in the lasers and isolating the mirrors from any kinds of disturbances, from fluctuations of molecules that might be there in the path of the laser beams, all of that requires significant engineering and technology. And I'll touch on that, but again, I'm happy to talk more about it in detail. But these are complicated beasts, and they are large. And there is a network of these around the world. I've already mentioned the two LIGO observatories in the US, which turned on in 2015. There's a German-British project, GEO, located in Germany, and you can see the LIGO observatories have the laser arms there, the beams that the laser beams travel a path that's 4 kilometers long in each of the arms. For GEO, it had 600 meter arms, a bit smaller. And Virgo is a French-Italian, and actually now more countries involved in Europe, project turned on in 2017. And there's also an instrument in Japan, CAGRA. So these are multiple big collaborations around the world working together. How did they come about? How did we get to that point of those turning on? Well, there were a series of proposals of people thinking about how they could build a big detector that would be sensitive enough. There was LIGO, you've heard about, in the USA. There was actually, again, before I joined the field, a British project. We had a British long baseline gravitational wave observatory proposal. And you can see there were no drones in those days. This meant sending somebody up in an aircraft with a camera to take a picture of the potential site, which I am told was on the old Balloch to Stirling Railway, if anybody knows the central belt of Scotland. There was a project in Germany. German colleagues proposed one. So partly this was the old bar detector projects using new technology. And then there was Virgo from France and Italy. There was, however, not enough funding in the UK to build one of these big instruments, nor was there on their own in Germany. But the two agencies got together and said, look, why don't you in the UK collaborate with colleagues in Germany, and we'll see what we can do between the countries. And so there was a joint proposal to build a joint gravitational wave detector. And again, this was 1989. I was still an undergraduate at this point, so again, I haven't joined the field yet. It was very exciting. This was a success, and the UK funding was awarded. I remember they bought the champagne in Glasgow. I was an undergraduate, but I remember the crates of champagne arriving. But they hadn't actually issued the award letter yet. There's a lesson in this. There was a change of leadership at the Research Council, who opened the books and looked at the finances and decided they just couldn't afford it. And at the same time in Germany, again, there was reunification, which, whilst a fantastic thing in many ways, placed financial burdens on the West and Germany. And so it did not go ahead, actually, which I think at the time was extremely disappointing, of course, for the scientists involved, especially because meantime, those projects in the US and in Europe were being funded, they were going ahead. So when I first joined the field as a PhD student, it was in the 91, I think, I joined a field where I was working in an area where it really wasn't clear how the UK was going to contribute, because these big projects around the world were going ahead and it wasn't happening in the UK. Never give up. So the leaders of the UK and German groups got together, had a workshop in Germany, did some brainstorming and came up with some advanced technology ideas that were quite risky, but meant you could build a smaller instrument, a smaller, cheaper instrument, Geo 600 that I mentioned earlier. Low cost, but high risk. And it turns out the more money people give you to spend, the more conservative you have to be with the technology. And that's particularly true in space missions, for instance, where things are often large space mission, things are often frozen quite early on because it costs a vast amount of money and all the technology's got to be absolutely spot on before you're allowed to put it in space. And it's often, I say, proportional to money. So we were able to be higher risk. And there was funding at that level, a much smaller level, available both in Germany and the UK, and so we got together, and that's the time that I joined. The LIGO observatories were ploughing ahead in the US, and they are phenomenal infrastructures. You can see here their locations, one in Hanford, up on the left here, and one in Livingston. And you can see the sort of pictures of those sites. They are huge, and I'll show you a little animation of that in a moment. And they require instrument science and technology development that absolutely is at the frontier of what you can do in measurement in physical science. This is a overview of the Hanford site. You can see those 4 kilometer long arms. And this is the Livingston site. So you can see that central building is about the size of a large supermarket. You get the idea of scale. And those 4 kilometer arms at right angles going off into the distance. So of course the lasers in the middle, laser beams going off, bouncing off mirrors, coming back again. And you can see the sites have quite different character. Hanford is a nuclear site. Again, if you ever visit the site, which you can do, you'll see it's in a dry, high desert area. You'll see nuclear reactors every now and again, nuclear materials made there. And out in the desert, you'll find the LIGO Observatory. Livingston, completely different. It's near Baton Rouge. It's about an hour from New Orleans, and it's in a swamp. And it literally is. You can see the trees. You can see up the arms of the detector pools of water where earth was dug out, actually, to make banks on top of which the arms of the instrument were put to raise them up above the flood level, the 100-year flood level. And if you dig a hole in a swamp, it fills with water. So they're filled both with water and indeed with local wildlife. The infrastructure is quite extraordinary. Light must travel in an excellent vacuum. We do not want molecules going through our laser beams. They'll start to make signals that might be confused or mask gravitational waves. Those pipes are about 1.2 meters in diameter. Laser beams go down the middle. They're covered with a concrete beam tube, and you can see here, for good reason, apparently this was an incident. It's a nuclear site. There was an alarm, a test alarm, in the middle of the night. The sort of site police got up in their car, drove off across the desert to see what was happening, forgot there was a 4 kilometer gravitational wave detector in the way. I am told the driver was fine, the instrument was fine, the car, as you can see, took a bit, but it wasn't fine. Everybody else was okay. Once you start to try and measure distances over 4 kilometers, that's enough that the Earth starts to curve. So the civil engineering is a challenge in itself, like, to make sure the arms were flat. So these are huge and, you know, sophisticated infrastructures. So I think back in 92, there was the start of work at the sites that proceeded on in the US, subsequent commissioning, taking first science. I think there are 6 science runs in total. But if you look back at the original proposal for those observatories, they were always envisaged as a 2-stage project. There was initial LIGO, and then an advanced version, for which the technology was not yet known, but people knew they'd need to get about another factor of 10 improvement in sensitivity to be sure of detecting gravitational waves. It was possible that they might have been detected with the initial instruments, but a second stage was always envisaged. So it wasn't a surprise when out of those science runs there was no concrete detections. It needed more sophisticated technology. Meanwhile, in GEO, we'd been building our smaller instrument, working on some more risky concepts. And the part that I particularly, there are various, but the part that I particularly worked on were the mirrors and the instruments and how to suspend those so that they are isolated as far as possible from external disturbances, that nothing else apart from a gravitational wave is going to shake them, because the isolation needed is very high. They have to have many requirements. We're using laser light to sense them, high power CW lasers, continuous wave laser light, it's infrared light, 1064 nanometers, which can be absorbed by the mirror. If it's absorbed too much, the mirrors actually distort. And you can see, I think this is sort of an initial LIGO scale mirror, which is about 10 kilograms. For the second stage of the instruments, that goes up to 40 kilograms. You still need it to be super low absorbing so that the absorbed heat doesn't distort the mirror. Thermal noise, every single atom and molecule in the mirror can vibrate because it's at room temperature. So they're all vibrating away, and that can excite motions, the resonant modes of a mirror, like a drum. Imagine banging a drum and seeing the surface vibrate. How much vibration you get depends on how much energy is dissipated, is used up in the material when it vibrates. You want to have, and that's an intrinsic property of the structure of the material. So glass, particularly pure glass, fusilica is pretty good. And you put a coating on the front, that also has thermal noise. It also needs, there's a whole bunch of optics technology in there. And you want all of that possible vibration to be very, very low at frequencies that for us are actually in the audio band, about 10 hertz to a kilohertz. It's where you can hear. Actually, that's the levels of vibration, the frequencies of vibration that we're trying to isolate against. So in GEO, actually what we did was take mirrors and suspend them not on metal wires, which are what was used in initial LIGO, but on glass, on fused silica. So fused silica fibers, again a few times the thickness of your hair, were used in GEO to support the mirrors, and people were very skeptical that you could suspend 10 or then 40 kilograms, but you know, a few kilograms on these fused silica fibers and not have them break. But actually they're very strong. If you look at the materials science, they can be stronger than steel in terms of glass and its strength. We were working on that in GEO. We were also working on more sophisticated interferometry techniques. I haven't talked about that at all, but there's a lot of additional optics and tricks in there to increase the sensitivity, and higher power lasers. Our colleagues in Germany were building lasers, again, of high power. So that, in fact, was all relevant, potentially, to go into that fabulous infrastructure we talked about earlier. And in Glasgow, we sort of led the UK effort working in this area. So what was I doing? I said I'd give you a personal perspective. Well, did my PhD, 91 to 95. 94, you'll remember, was that workshop, thinking about new ideas. I did a postdoc, actually, when I finished my PhD, back and forward between Stanford and Glasgow, and I actually went to Stanford in 1998 to work there for a bit in the gravitational waves group there, working on making sure the geotechnology was being developed, also thinking about how that might be relevant for the US. And actually, while I was there learning a completely new language, I learned about IPOs, I learned about startups, I learned about your stock vesting. Those were the words I heard in the in the corridor, because it was a remarkable time to be in the Bay Area in the US. I think there are decades, times in life where in different parts of the world you feel like the universe is revolving around you. In the 1980s, perhaps that was New York. Again, it was the stock market. The 1960s, it was maybe London. You know, you were at the height of the swinging 60s. Well, in around 2000, it felt like the Bay Area was the middle of the universe, because the time I was there was coincident with the dot-com boom. I realize for the youngsters in the audience, this is like ancient history to you. But the world changed remarkably during that period, and it was a remarkable time to be there. You can look this up. There was a bubble, an enormous bubble in tech stock, the dot-com bubble. Between 96 and 2000, the NASDAQ, so the tech stock exchange in the US, shot through the roof in terms of value, from 600 to almost 5,000 points. There were huge number of IPOs, initial public offerings, on the stock market, most of which were internet or technology. There were a lot of light-related things. If you could get light in the name of your company, that was a good thing. And the stock market, this is what the NASDAQ did during that time. You don't need to even read the numbers at the back. You can see there was this enormous spike. Now, for context, that's 1998. That's when I arrived in the Bay Area. That's 2003. That's when I left the Bay Area. I would like to remind you at this point, correlation is not causation. I was not responsible in any way, either for the peak or the trough. But what it did mean, you know, working at Stanford during that time was a remarkable experience in terms of, you know, working in a high-tech lab where people were very focused actually on spin-offs, on a lot of people did consulting. It was a completely different environment than I was used to, certainly in Scotland, and it was a remarkable time. You know, PhD students would come in and they had no intention of becoming professors. They were all going to join a startup, get bought over and become a multimillionaire. That was absolutely what they wanted to do, and they thought people like me were maybe a bit crazy. Again, what was I thinking? That crazy gravity wave stuff, what are you thinking? So it was a remarkable environment, and I enjoyed it tremendously. And towards the end of that time, we were in the position where, having demonstrated things in geo, LIGO was looking at its next stage, and based on some of our technology, but also the technology in different ways from US colleagues, but some of our technology, we became partners in the LIGO observatories from 2003 onwards, taking our technology here in the UK, again with a group of people, and working with colleagues in the US to install it in the LIGO observatories to improve the sensitivity of the big instruments. But even in the 2000s, again, Max talked at the beginning about risk. Working in the field of gravitational waves was still a risky business. And so what you'll see on a slide there is a betting slip. Just cut off at the top, you'll see Ladbrokes. This was Ladbrokes. And actually in 2004, I think it was in collaboration with New Scientist magazine, they cooked up a story that Ladbrokes would run some bets on the odds of particular types of scientific discovery. And one of those you can see there was that the laser interferometer gravitational wave observatory LIGO, that the odds of it detecting gravitational waves by 2010. So this was back in the 2000s. Remember, we're putting our technology in. It's 2004. We know we are going to make them more sensitive. And what happened was we were in the office one day, and a colleague from outside of the field, but who knew the field well, phoned up and said, have you seen what this story, have you seen what Ladbrokes are offering? They're offering 600 to 1 on detecting gravitational waves with LIGO. You guys are working on that. You know, you should get in on this. I've put money on this. So, you know, he phoned the office, my colleague Jim Huff, who saw you there, is my PhD supervisor, as was. We are not betting people, so we had to log on to Ladbrokes and figure out how to set up an account. And by the time we'd done that, the odds had dropped from 600 to 1 to 100 to 1 that you can see on the betting slip there, because word had got around. And if people were logging on and they were placing bets, and Ladbrokes were dropping the odds. And so by the time our PhD students figured out this was happening at the end of the day, they were getting 6 to 1. And then Ladbrokes closed the bet because they were exposed. And they were worried. I think it was Mr. Warren Lush, if I remember correctly. They were exposed and they were worried they judged wrong. People had told them, those guys are never going to detect gravitational waves. Ah, that's a good one. And the flurry of betting meant they closed the book. Now, that was back to, so we placed our bets and thought no more about it. I think the BBC ran a story at the time. It was a story at the time. And after we detected gravitational waves, of course, this they remembered that this had happened. And I did an interview, and you can see I'm quoted there as saying, the chances of detecting gravitational waves before 2010 were considered possible, but not probable in 2004, but still way better than 100 to 1, said the astrophysicists. Or, to put it in British scientific terms, it was worth a punt, according to Professor Rowan. So apparently that's what I said. And to this day, this remains my favourite piece of publicity, I think, that we got from the detection. It's casino.org, that well-known scientific publication. It's a betting publication in the US, again, who ran this story. So it literally was something. But the money was nothing, because what you have to remember is people in the field had staked their scientific careers on this, on something that people thought, again, for many, many years, was not possible. Of course, it was possible. You know the end of the story. On 14th September 2015, that first gravitational wave signal was detected, and it was from two colliding black holes. It was detected in both observatories. And it was detected in September 2015, but the paper was not published, and the announcement, the press conference was not given until February, I think, 2016, because it took 6 months to check and check and check and check again, because the history of the field was such, of course, with Joe Weber having claimed a detection and it not turning out to be true, and all the sort of, you know, interest in the field. There was a huge amount of work done by many, many people to check the instruments. It came very soon. It came actually just before we officially turned on. So it really was a surprise again. And it took people by surprise. And it took, I think, a while for it to sink in what we had achieved. It, of course, made a big splash when it was announced. It was on the front page of many newspapers around the world. There's many different languages represented there. And it is rare that a science story is not only front page news, but is front page good news. It's a resolutely good news story. So there are this network of detectors now. I talked about the LIGO observatories, but the Virgo was part of the collaboration at that point, but the observatory wasn't quite ready until 2017. There's coming, again, another LIGO-like observatory in India. And why do we need so many of these? You say you had to, you made a detection, why do you need so many? Well, gravitational wave detectors are a bit more like a microphone than they are a telescope. If you have a telescope, you point and look on the hole, that portion of the sky. But if you've got a microphone, it's sensitive to vibrations coming from many directions, and that's true of gravitational wave detectors. Each one has some directional sensitivity, but it's weak. So if you want to know where in the universe your signal came from, typically what you do is you time when it arrived at one instrument, when it arrived at another instrument, and from that you triangulate and you work backwards to where it must have come from in the sky. With one instrument, you have some sensitivity, but it's pretty weak. With two, you do better, you can do some. But to really be able to pinpoint where something came from in the sky, which we want to do, to talk to our colleagues who do have telescopes looking for optical and other electromagnetic signals, because not all sources of gravitational waves are black holes, then you need more instruments. And in truth, you need about five. So that network that I showed you is really what you need to do to narrow down the uncertainty and know where in the sky a signal is coming from. And there are sources out there like this one, different kinds of sources of gravitational waves. Here, this animation is of two neutron stars. So what happens when a star collapses just before it reaches a black hole? It can make something called a neutron star. Two neutron stars caught in one another's gravity spiraling, and they are made of real stuff. When they smash into one another, a whole bunch of exciting physics happens, and electromagnetic signals are produced of different kinds. So this time, you get the gravitational wave signal. Those neutron stars are distorting space-time. The gravitational waves are rippling out in the moments before they collide. But when they collide, then there's a whole bunch of other stuff to see. But you need to know where to look. You need to know where to point your telescopes. So with our network of gravitational wave detectors, that we can do. And indeed, a source like that was detected, as you'll have seen, in August 2017. And it was picked up in gravitational waves, and first of all, actually, by gamma ray bursts, short wavelength electromagnetic signals, gamma ray signals, picked up by some satellites. You'll see the gravitational wave signal ends just under 2 seconds before the gamma rays actually are picked up. So there's a time delay there, which has physics associated with it. And this event, again, August 17th, 2017, we give our signals names. It looks like a meaningless string of numbers, but GW is just gravitational wave, and then it's the date, 2017, August 17. That's what the number means. The physics from that one event, where actually it was first detected, the gamma rays were picked up, and then we looked in our gravitational wave data and said, gosh, yes, there's the gravitational wave signal. That information went out. We were able to suggest to people where to look, and actually the pointing accuracy from the gravitational wave signals was slightly better than from the gamma ray bursts. People then slewed their telescopes. Again, a whole bunch of observatories around the world looked to see what could be seen and did a remarkable job in picking up the electromagnetic signals from this event. Putting all that together, again, there's an extraordinary set of publications that came out of that, extraordinary science. I'm not going to talk about them all. One, though, the speed of gravitational waves compared with light, we're able to set a limit on that, because knowing the distance out, again, you can know the time it took for the signals to leave and then arrive with us, and they arrived within 1.7 seconds of one another. So you set a limit on the relative speeds of gravity and light. It's predicted that they travel at the same speed, and actually the error bar is remarkably small, that 1.7 seconds over the distance. And there's a whole bunch of physics that you can do with that. Independent gravitational measure of of the rate of expansion of our universe, you can get that from this. The last one, though, again, confirmation of what's called the kilonova scenario. Where are heavy elements made in the universe? And that we got from knowing these were neutron stars, looking at the electromagnetic signals, you could tell what elements were being produced. And actually, this rather lovely periodic table tells you where the elements are coming from. And if you look at gold and platinum, they are, we believe from this observation, partly coming from merging neutron stars. So you may have noticed that lovely artist's impression had a lot of gold and silver in there. That's why. And it's we made the front page of the Financial Times, again, another well-known scientific paper. I can only assume because they were very interested in where that gold and silver was coming from. It has been a field that has been really caught the public imagination. Just a couple of examples. The chap in the top left there is Cameron McAvoy. He's an Australian Olympic swimmer, and he had all his swimming caps imprinted with the gravitational wave signal on them from the first detection. The picture is from the Royal Albert Hall, and there was a symphony composed inspired by the detection of gravitational waves, and I was lucky enough to be in the audience and go get to hear that, so it has been inspirational. Lots of other science, and I don't have time to talk about it all. Let me give you one example. You can sense a theme. We're detecting waves from things spiraling and colliding. Some of them are pairs of black holes. Some of them are that pair of neutron stars. Here, there was a particular detection in 2019 where it was a black hole and something that we can't tell if it was a black hole or a neutron star. There's a kind of gap in terms of mass up the left-hand side here. It's the number of times the mass of the sun. Where from other observations, there's a kind of upper limit to where we see neutron stars in terms of mass and a lower limit to where we see black holes. Our observations suggested there was something kind of from that gap, and it could be the heaviest neutron star ever or the lightest black hole. So there's new physics sort of to be dug out from that. Black holes, it turns out, from prior observations, you see black holes in the range of, you know, a few tens of times the mass of our sun, and then you see huge black holes that there are at the centres of galaxies. There'd been no prior observations of black holes of mass in the middle, and nobody really understood why. Maybe they couldn't be formed. One of our detections, remember, we can get the masses of the black holes weighed in at 142 times the mass of the sun. The first time there was an observation really telling us that they do exist. So that had physics associated with it. People didn't know how to form those from the collapsing star model. Either it's wrong, or those black holes are forming pairs colliding, more pairs colliding, and making heavier and heavier black holes. So there's physics to come out. Where are we now? Again, this is a sort of catalogue. All the blue dots are pairs of are black holes. The orange dots are neutron stars. So we're building up the statistics of what's happening here. And through that, we can start to learn what's happening. Again, remember, we couldn't see at all some of these objects before. This is a whole new set of observations with new physics coming along with it. Where are we going? Well, you heard the story of we started small, we improved the technology, we made them bigger. Our current observatories, again, they're running at the moment, are picking up black hole collisions at the rate of about 2 a week. We're still only probing the local universe, and so there are plans to build larger detectors with even more advanced technologies. There's a couple of concepts, and the UK is currently involved in both. The Einstein telescope, which is likely to be located in Europe, and as you can see, located underground again for more isolation from disturbances, and one called Cosmic Explorer in the US, potentially even larger, 40 kilometer long arms. And each of those also requires us to improve the technology. Bigger detectors, maybe putting them underground, higher power lasers, not 40 kilogram mirrors this time, but 160 kilograms or more, perhaps no longer made of glass, maybe made of silicon, so we can cool it down to cryogenic temperatures and get rid of thermal noise. Lots and lots of technology. That technology has spin-offs. We benefit from that work in many ways, not just in the observatories. I won't go through all of these, but they're all ones actually my group in Glasgow has been involved in. It's healthcare, using our understanding of vibration to help turn stem cells into bone, again with applications in bone growth. Working with companies that make retinal devices to scan the retina of the eye and improving their quality control, and you can quantify the number of more patients a day who are able to be treated because of that work. So there's a whole bunch of spin-offs in there. Everything I have talked about today is only one portion of the gravitational wave spectrum. If it was the electromagnetic spectrum, you'd be measuring gamma rays and x-rays and light and optical and radio. Everything I've talked about is like one of those. It's just using the ground-based observatories. There are fabulous sources like supermassive black holes at the center of galaxies spiraling in and colliding that we won't be able to detect here on Earth because the vibrations, the ground vibrations are too large. For those, we would put detectors in space. There are other techniques, pulsar timing, looking at the signals from the early universe that will give us a whole bunch of different physics. So we really are just at the start. So despite the fact I said that this is how things looked close to the beginning, I really do think that there's a bright future ahead. And I will stop there. Thank you.
Thank you, Sheila. And I think you mentioned one of my papers that I was co-author on. So that was fantastic as well. Thank you. I'm now going to invite Sheila to sit with me and we'll take some questions from the audience. So maybe if we could have a little bit of the lights, because I won't be able to see anybody who puts their hands up. That would be great. And hopefully people can still hear us. So Sheila, if you don't mind taking a seat, help yourself to some water. We'll have some stronger drinks later. So if you don't mind, Sheila, I'm going to start and I'm going to have my one chairperson's question, if that's allowed. So as a cosmologist who is having lots of fun at the beginning of the 20th century, 21st century, fantastic discoveries with our optical and infrared telescopes. I was one of those skeptics, okay? And we used to sit on each other's panels. How did you remain, even when your fellow scientists, who should have really understood what was going on, how did you remain so engaged? How did you stay motivated to even push against the skeptics like me? And before you answer, I'm sorry. And I rarely say this, my colleagues will know this, I was wrong and you were right.
So, well, first of all, thanks, Bob. That apology is much appreciated. So it's a good question, and actually it's quite a serious one. I mean, over the years, even until quite, as I showed you, the 2000s, you know, 2004, there was a lot of skepticism. And right up until, you know, we detected in 2015, we had PhD students in place at that point who, when they told people they were going to come do a PhD in gravitational wave physics, people would say to them, why are you doing that? That's a waste. You've just, you know, wasted your career. You're crazy. And people would say that to young people who wanted to join the field. One of our PhD students in Glasgow who'd come from outside told me that people had said that to her. So a few things. So again, a personal perspective. When you're young, you don't know any better. So when I joined the field, I did my PhD in Glasgow. And Glasgow, actually, at that point, there were very few places in the UK who were in the field. I did an undergraduate project with a group in Glasgow, and I kind of liked them, and they seemed like smart people, and it seemed good fun.
Very fashionable as well.
Apparently, they had, I think he'd moved on from the corduroy jackets at that point, but, you know, it was the group, I liked the idea that you could do something in the lab, because we were doing work hands-on in the lab. You could do something that was meaningful, potentially with a grand aim. And then I looked at the people we were collaborating with, and you'll see in the US it was Caltech and MIT and Stanford, and those are not shoddy institutions. You know, they seem like smart people to me. And they were all, you know, convinced that this would work. The experimental capability is quite extraordinary. The ability to make precision measurements. And those folks were really, really good. And there is an excitement in doing, for me as an experimenter, in working in the labs. You have short-term milestones that you achieve that are exciting on the technological side. And there were people in the relativity field, again, Bernard Schutz at Cardiff and others, Kip Thorne in the US, who, you know, were convinced that the astrophysics side was there. And the other thing I should say is, you know, the fact that gravitational waves existed, there was a Nobel Prize, I think, in 93 that went to Hulson Taylor for indirect evidence of the existence of gravitational waves from the orbits of stars, and the decay of those orbits was absolutely in agreement with general relativity. And they made, again, phenomenal observations of that over long periods, and they got the Nobel Prize for that. So they were out there. For us, I think the only uncertainty was exactly how many of them are there. What are the rates of those collisions? Are they often enough that when we, the experimenters, build our instruments, we'll live long enough to see something? As it happened, as you heard with Advanced LIGO, it came before we were even ready. It was so fast. That was a surprise. So, you know, I'd bought in. I was, you know, convinced I was working with good people who I couldn't fault the people. They were, you know, really talented. So you persevere on.
Pick your team. I think that's
it.
Pick your team. So I'm sure loads of people have questions. My goodness, we've already got hands up. So I'm going to start at the back with the gentleman right there with the glasses that I'm pointing to. Hopefully there's a microphone, and then we will move forward through the audience. How about that?
Thanks for sharing the slide, in particular on future opportunities. in that area, would you describe it as one of incremental improvement, or is there something out there that you personally are looking at going, you know what, if we were able to do this, it would increase the accuracy of measurement by 1,000 or 1,000,000? Is there anything out there that you in your head are going, I wish we were able to do this?
So there's we're looking, it's not incremental. That's the first thing. The change between the current observatories and the ones that I showed you, it would be another factor of 10 in sensitivity. But because of the way the observatories work, that's a factor of 10 cubed 1,000 in terms of volume and sources that we can probe. So you go from, you're looking at hundreds of thousands of detections. And that is extraordinary. So one of the things, there's a whole bunch of things that will be possible with that. One of which is probes of general relativity with extreme precision. So when you've got two black holes that merge, there's physics that's in some ways not really measurable yet in terms of how they merge, in terms of their event horizons, and general relativity makes predictions. But there are a whole bunch of other theories of gravity out there. General relativity has passed everything with flying colours. But I gave a talk at a relativity conference in the before COVID times, and I talked to one of my colleagues, Sathya Prakash, who was at Cardiff, who's now at Penn State. I said, I'm going to talk to a bunch of relativity theorists. What should I say to them? And he said, you tell them, you show them the signal to noise ratio we're going to get for these events. They're going to be huge. And you tell them that they should start making predictions from their alternative theories of gravity. Because we are going to be able to probe things with such precision that, you know, those theories we should now be able to actually really stretch and test. To get there, for the technologies, you'll see I put up a list. We need a whole bunch of different technologies. Making the instruments bigger actually turns out to be one relatively straightforward, but there's not quite that simple, of course, way to improve the sensitivity. At the same time, we will need larger optics, because one of the sources of noise in our instruments, didn't talk about this, but it's called radiation pressure. So we hang our mirrors, they're hanging there, they're almost motionless, and then we shine a beam of light off the mirrors and it bounces off them. So I talked about light as being a wave, but of course the other way you can perfectly reasonably think of light is as a stream of particles, of individual photons. Each of those photons has momentum, and when it bounces off the mirror, it transfers momentum to the mirror. So if you have many, many photons, it's rattling the mirror, transferring them and shaking the mirror. That's called radiation pressure. The heavier the mirror, the lower that effect is. So one of the things we'll do is make the mirrors heavier. We'll also make their faces larger, because as the beam senses the front face of the mirror, each of those atoms and molecules is vibrating. We essentially average, that's the thermal noise, we can average that away by making the beams bigger, because they're averaging over a larger number of individual motions. So we also want to make them, so there's good motivation for making them bigger. So there are point designs for these instruments to get that extra factor of 10. There's different ways you can look at the different technologies, the different approaches in the instruments, but we are working on incremental improvements, but to get that extra factor of 10, we see the jumps that need made.
I'm going to predict there were more relativity, alternative gravity theories at the conference than there were participants. Am I right?
That might be true. That might be true. I don't know.
I'm going to take one from this side of the room, coming down from the top. Is there anybody? The gentleman there, you were quickest.
Did you learn something from discovering
So that betting slip I showed you was too slow, but that was Jim Huff's, which I helped him place, and he placed £25 and got 100 to 1. So,
but he didn't.
But we,
because it was by 2010.
Because it was by 2010. But when we did make the detection and the BBC ran the story again, Ladbrokes got back in touch. And they'd looked at this because they were getting a lot of publicity out of that story again. They suddenly saw, presumably in their social media, everybody was like looking at Ladbrokes, and they felt really bad about the fact that they were getting all this publicity and we didn't get any money. So they had looked at it to see if they could pay out, but the problem was if they paid us, they'd have to pay everyone who placed a bet, and they still couldn't afford it.
Hold on, are you saying there's a bookie that wanted to pay out?
Yes.
Like, well, that might be your biggest discovery, Sheila. I'm going to shift over to this side of the room and start at the top and look down. There's another gentleman there with the glasses, with the pink shirt.
Sorry, can you say something about pulsar timing arrays and their ability to detect gravitational waves with very long wavelengths?
So I can say a little. Actually, Bob might want to comment on that.
No,
too,
I don't, actually.
I'll say a little.
I'll start.
So that's a technique for looking at, make sure I get this right, changes in the arrival time of the light from spinning neutron stars, which are a bit like lighthouses. They have a sort of beam that comes out, and they're very, very accurate in terms of their rotation. They are out there in the universe, natural sort of objects. Gravitational waves can distort the pulsar positions, and we see that here on Earth potentially in terms of the timing, the arrival time of the signals from those. But those are looking for gravitational waves of even lower frequency than the ones we talked about here. And I think there's been some very interesting work announced recently in that area about a potential signal seen by the pulsar collaborations. So again, it's a different wave band. I think those are sort of looking at motions of supermassive black holes. I don't know if you want to.
And also they might be potentially leftover ringing from the Big Bang. So that's where they get the very excited by.
So,
thank you for an excellent talk.
Thank you.
Okay, I'll come back. I'm gonna take the lady in the front there.
Thank you for the talk. And what do you think gravitational waves can show us about the point of the Big Bang?
So it's a very good question. So one of the long-term potential sources of interest for us with our next generation and perhaps even more sensitive instruments and the space-based gravitational wave detector is looking for signals from the early universe. And gravitational waves are very interesting because there is a model of inflation that suggests gravitational waves were produced earlier in the universe than the light signals, the cosmic microwave background that we can see. There's a sort of limit to how far back we can see, and it's from light, and it's the cosmic microwave background. Gravitational waves actually potentially were produced in the early universe, sort of density fluctuations producing gravitational waves, that would give us information, again, that we can't get from any other observations. Our current instruments are not sensitive enough for the most popular theories of cosmology. It would have to be something fairly radical in terms of what happened in the early universe to produce something big enough for us to see with our current instruments. But as that's a real target, because we would be able to see beyond the limit set by the cosmic microwave, but earlier in the universe than anything else can tell us. So it's a tantalizing proposition to be able to detect gravitational waves.
You'll never see it. okay, then I'm going to give a question to Alf in front, and then the question after that will be to someone who's the youngest in the audience. So if you're the youngest in the audience, think up a question. Alf.
This was based on the idea I'm the oldest, is it? So is it correct then? I'm surprised that when space expands, the wavelength of light travelling through it doesn't change.
So it's a good point. It's one people often worry about. So the wavelength, so in truth, gravitational waves can affect both the distance, the space, and the wavelength of light. And there are different ways in which you can sort of model the behavior of a gravitational wave detector you can actually pick a reference frame in which the light wavelength stays the same, but the mirrors move, or conversely, the mirrors don't move, but the wavelength of light changes. In truth, they both change, but they don't cancel out. So, and it's non-obvious that that would be the case, and it's very difficult to give you a sort of heuristic explanation. There's a paper actually by Peter Solson in which he gives an attempt to explain that.
Is this because time is changing also?
It's true. We talk a lot about distances, but it's really a discussion in space-time. You're correct.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Another old person.
So Max, I was going to give it to the youngest person. So, and I know it's your birthday soon, so I know your age. So
I'm getting old. Really fascinating, Sheila. I think as an engineer, I'm fascinated about the amount of technology you develop as a scientist. So put the engineer to shame, because I think the kind of technology you develop, the mirrors, the precisions, it really says that, whether seeing astronomy or in medicine, technology engineering plays a key role.
Absolutely.
So this year we saw the Nobel Prize winners, the attosecond lasers. Do you see this future, the bright future ahead, would involve attosecond synchronization of microwave or optical signals together to have that kind of even higher precision?
So if I understand correctly, in terms of laser development, I mean, frequency comb work, getting super stable lasers? So I think the stability of the lasers is something that we can do. I think there is work looking at the potential use of frequency combs actually for producing signals at different wavelengths for control purposes. I mean, there's a whole bunch of engineering and technology that I didn't have a chance to talk about, but in our big instruments, it's not just the simple case I showed you. If your light upbeam splitter bounces off a mirror and comes back, there are actually cavities, optical cavities in the arms of the instruments. And those cavities, the laser light has to be resonant within those cavities. There are other mirrors, again, that we also use, ancillary mirrors, that form other cavities. So there's a complicated control system problem in keeping all of those cavities resonant at the same time. We can use different wavelengths of light to give us a different signal than the main signal to help actually with that control. So people are considering potentially the use of frequency combs to get stable light at a variety of frequencies actually to help with the control system problem.
X-ray electron free.
I'm not sure it needs that. I think the current laser, I'm not sure it needs those specific lasers, but definitely frequency comb technology. We're looking at switching wavelengths. The current observatories use 1064 infrared light. In future, if we switch to silicon optics, it's not transmissive at 1064, so we actually might use longer wavelengths. Whole bunch of laser development is ongoing in different labs around the world. Again, looking at this, the number of people, it's a real multidisciplinary field, because we need engineers and we need optical physicists. We need, electronic engineers. We need material scientists. So it makes it a fascinating field to work in.
Great. I feel we do have one more question in us, and I am going to see if there's a youngster out there that wants to put their hand up. Oh, Sheila, you found one. Great. Okay, the lady in the glasses there.
Thank you. This might be a silly question, but would it be possible for gravitational waves from different directions to interfere with each other and superpose?
So, they are the waves you can imagine travelling through the universe. There are some sources for which the number of sources in a particular wave band is so large, we get what's called confusion noise. And actually, for the space-based gravitational wave detectors, There are smaller kinds of stars called white dwarfs, white dwarf binary systems. There's so many of those that they actually form a limit to the potential limit to the sensitivity of the instrument. There's so many signals all coming in. So for the ones that we have, you can see they're discrete in time, so we don't have to worry so much about those things.
Great. Well, I'm going to ask you to put your hands together one more time for Sheila. Thank you very much. And if you don't mind, Sheila, you don't mind standing up.
Not at all.
I have a very fitting gift for you.
God.
So Sheila, it feels very fitting that we give you the material this is made of. Seems very fitting. I hadn't realized, I'm sure Noel, when he got this, didn't realize how appropriate it was. But this is on behalf of the University of Surrey. And thank you for giving the Adams Sweeting lecture.
My pleasure. Thank you very much. See what we have. Oh, wow. That is beautiful. There we go. I'd like to see what's in the box. That's lovely. Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you for coming tonight.